welcome you all to morning worship. Welcome to the 12 o'clock service. Would you please sign the red friendship pad, which you'll find at the end of the pew, and share it with those worshiping with you. If you're here for the first time, there's a yellow card somewhere around where you're sitting, and if you take out your yellow card and turn it in the back after church, we'll give you a coffee mug for it. We hope you will do that. It's a wonderful mug and worth your email address and the name of your firstborn, etc. I want to give a few other announcements. Next Sunday is our stewardship Sunday, and we have a special guest preacher who happens to be nearby, Dr. Bob Shetler, recently retired, and he will be here to give the message. And really excited about having Bob here. So I hope you all will come next Sunday. At that service, you will receive pledge cards. If you forget your pledge card, we will send a pledge card to your house later in the week. And if you forget that pledge card, we'll have another pledge card here in the pew racks. You will see a pledge card. We guarantee it. Thank you for your support of your church. For Presbyterian Women, is their fall gathering this coming Saturday at 1:30, Saturday, November 9th, in the Fellowship Hall. The thank offering will be collected at that time. There's already been a great turnout today for our mission fair. I'm very pleased to see many of you over there today and looking at some of the ministries that you support with your gifts here at First Presbyterian Church. There's also the serve sale, which means you can buy crafts made from around the world, which are the money which you, when you buy those, goes straight to the people who made them. This announcement is missing from your bulletin, but we would like for you all to start signing up for Thanksgiving dinner. That will be in next week's bulletin, I feel sure, but it's not there today. Also, the Art Connection meets not this Wednesday, but the following Wednesday. Is that correct, Mary? Yes, thank you. And of course, interfaith needs are listed as the weather starts to turn colder and maybe eventually cold. We get more and more clients over at the interfaith agency. So please not only keep them in your prayers and support them, but you can bring food gifts that will go to people in need. Let us now prepare ourselves for worship.
Thank you. for worship. Your righteousness is an everlasting righteousness, O Lord, and your law is the truth.
Your decrees are righteous forever, O God. Give me understanding and I may live.
Let us worship God. Please stand as you're able for our first hymn of praise for all the saints in your hymnals 326.
Keep us strong in our faith as we worship you, and bless us this day, for we ask it in Christ Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Righteous God, redeem it just to repay with affliction those who mistreat your children.
Forgive the sins we commit which harm our neighbors. Temper your vengeance when we claim not to know you. Ease your wrath when we fail to obey the gospel of Christ taught. Let the glory of our might undergird our efforts, as though Christ you deliver us from our weakness and shame. O God, have mercy upon us and fill us with your splendor.
Amen. To this end, we always pray for you, asking that our God will make you worthy of God's call and will fulfill every good resolve and work of faith, so that the name of our Lord Jesus may be glorified in you and you in him, according to the grace of our God and the Lord Jesus Christ. In Christ's name we are forgiven. Amen.
Forgiven people of God, share the peace of Christ with one another. May the peace of Christ be with you.
Also with you.
Please share with your neighbor.
Peace be with you.
Before we pray, I do need to give you updates. It has been a difficult week in the life of the church. We say goodbye to Bobby Richardson on Friday. Mary Dingman's mother passed away on Monday. You have probably heard that or read it in your bulletin. Claudia Martin Hall, who was a member of Silver Springs Church, but a member of one of our circles, her husband, Brian, died unexpectedly on Monday, and she is up in New York State. Some of you remember Paul and Betty Haught, who were members for many years here and moved to Illinois, back home to Illinois. Betty was in the hospital, and Paul died also unexpectedly. Ron and Mary McMillan in our church, you know well, yesterday, their daughter, Lisa Marie, died, again, unexpectedly. And we have heavy hearts for our brothers and sisters who lost someone they loved this week and or said goodbye. And we pray together as God's people for God's mercy and for God's love. Let us pray. Gracious God, we give thanks for the saints, and they continue to join you, and we will all join you one day. But we are given solace in the knowledge that in life and in death and in life beyond death, we belong to you, O God. From you we have come, and to you we will one day return. Be with those who have lost someone they love this week, or over the last last few weeks, or maybe long ago, but still are carrying a great burden of grief. Let us show our love to those who are missing someone today. Let us show our open hearts. Let us be the feet and hands of Christ as we show that love. We thank you also, O God, for our local missions and regional missions who are here with us today, telling us about their ministries. We thank you that you give us the ability to support them, and we pray that that support will continue, that in many ways we can offer a cold cup of water in the name of Christ Jesus, that we may take those who are hurting and those who are suffering and give them the relief that we know in Christ Jesus. Be with those who are sick today. Give them strength and give them the presence of your Holy Spirit, and continue to draw us together in unity with you, Father, Son, and Spirit, world without end. Amen. Let's continue to worship God by bringing God our gifts, our tithes, and offerings. Thank you. all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us in what we have gathered in feeding the world with your love, through the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
First scripture lesson is from Isaiah 1, 10 through 18, the Old Testament, page 771, if you want to follow in your pew Bibles. Hear the word of the Lord, you rulers of Sodom. Listen to the teachings of our God, you people of Gomorrah. What to me is a multitude of your sacrifices, says the Lord. I have had enough of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of goats. When you come to appear before me, who asks this from your hand? Trample my courts no more. Bringing offerings is futile. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath and calling it convocation, I cannot ensure solemn assemblies with inequity. Your new moons and your appointed festivals my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you stretch out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourselves, make yourselves clean. Remove the evils of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, and plead for the widow. Come now, let us argue it out, says the Lord. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be like snow. Though they are red like crimson, they shall become like wool.
Thank you, Ed Albright, our elder of the day. Our gospel lesson is from Luke. We are still in Luke in the lectionary, chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. Today I present a story with a happy ending that you all love. We all love stories that have happy endings, and this is one of them. He, that is Jesus, entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not, because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him, because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today. So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, he has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner. Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much. Then Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. And may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O God, our strength, our rock, and our redeemer. Amen. There's an old story about a fisherman. A fisherman who was very successful. Every morning he went out to the lake in his small boat, and when he returned a couple of hours later, his boat was loaded down with fish. He never failed. People wondered how he did it. Even when others were not catching anything at all, the fish didn't seem to be biting. He always came in with his boat just overflowing with fish. One morning, a stranger showed up with his fishing tackle and said, mind if I go fishing with you this morning? No, said the fisherman. Just hop in and we'll go to a little cove where I always seem to have some luck. The man hopped in the boat and off they headed across the lake until they came to that small cove. The old fisherman stopped the boat and cut off the motor. He He reached into his tackle box and took out a stick of dynamite. He lit the fuse and held it for a moment as the fuse burned down. And then in the last moment, he tossed it into the water, and there was a tremendous explosion. Fish were everywhere on the water. He picked up his net and began scooping up the fish. After watching this for a moment, the stranger reached into his pocket, pulled out his wallet, opened it up, and he showed his badge and said, "I'm a game warden and you are under arrest." The old fisherman simply reached back into his tackle box, pulled out another stick of dynamite. He lit it, and as the fuse burned down, he tossed it to the game warden and said, "Now, are you just gonna sit there or are you gonna fish?" There comes a time in our lives when we are faced with a big decision, when there is a stick of dynamite tossed to us, and we know the moment is now to do something. Zacchaeus had such a moment. Maybe it was only curiosity that drove him to see who Jesus was, but he made it to that tree and climbed it. But how close did he want to get to Jesus? We know he wanted to see Jesus. And it's such a wonderful story. Like I said, Zacchaeus is a hero. We talk about Zacchaeus to our children. At one of the services, we sang the Zacchaeus song, which I will spare you my rendition of right now. But so many of you know it, and many sang it beautifully at the last service. Zacchaeus is our hero because this story has a good ending. We have a guy who is not really a good guy. In fact, we know he's a bad person. We know him to be a bit of a thief and a cheat. We understand that tax collectors had to answer to Rome and not to the Jewish people. And as an occupying force, the Romans did not care that the Jewish people were paying more taxes than they ought to. They only wanted their cut. And so here was a man who was on the edge, on the fringe, someone who not only might have been short of stature, but really did not belong in the society in which he lived. And Jesus reached out to this man. And that's why we love this story. But what's it like? Let's look at that metaphor for a minute. Climbing a tree and being out on a limb. I was not very good at climbing trees. I came from a city that had lots of pine trees with no limbs. I was actually quite flummoxed at the idea of climbing trees at all. We had little dogwoods that if you climbed it, it would probably break on your third pull. And then these giant, tall pine trees that were impossible to climb. And yet, this man climbed a tree and he got out on that limb. What's it like on the limb? Precarious, unsustainable ultimately. We know eventually, today or tomorrow, or with the wrong wind, that the limb will eventually break and we will fall. Who will catch us? What will catch us? The grace that we know in God. And we are God's elect. We are not chosen because we are worthy, but precisely because we are not. We have much more in common with this tax collector than we might like to admit. It is the powerful act of God's grace that finds us and catches us from the limb. When we hear God's call, we risk leaving our comfort zone. Zacchaeus may not look comfortable to you as he is perched on a tree trying to see Jesus, but he is. It is from that sight you can get a glimpse of the amazing man. He can look in wonder and amazement from a comfortable, safe distance. And by staying away, he can claim a kinship with this amazing Jesus without having to get his hands dirty, without making any changes in his life. And some people come to church that way. Their heads are, as well as their hearts, stay clean, stay a safe distance away from this changing act of grace in Jesus, the act that makes us come down from our safe repose in the tree. We tend to participate in the ritual of our religion, but stay safely away. The prophet Isaiah knew this well and says, "What to me is the multitude of your sacrifices, says God, bringing offerings is futile. Incense is an abomination to me. Wash yourselves." And we think of our baptism immediately. "Make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your doings before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. Seek justice. Rescue the oppressed. Defend the orphan. Plead for the widow," says the prophet. And today, that couldn't be more important as we talk about our local mission, because our local mission that we celebrate next door, and if you haven't been, you should go after this service. It's going to be open till 12:15, to see our ministry partners who work with just such people, people who are oppressed, people who need defense. What the God of the Old Testament called for is the same thing that Jesus called to Zacchaeus. Come down from your comfort zone and stop pretending that you believe. Come down from your lofty places and see the work that God has done. The places and situations that we consider temporary or simply way stations turn out to be the places or situations that end up holding the most significance for us. Henry Nouwen once said in his ministry, he found himself becoming frustrated and resentful that his work was constantly being interrupted by other people who wanted or needing something from him, until the one day the Lord spoke to him and revealed that his real work was in those interruptions. Zacchaeus figured it out. I think we have to pay attention to the transit points on our journey. You can tell we've heard the call when we undergo outward physical change. If you come off your limb answering the call of the Lord, you will live a life differently than otherwise. You will have compassion on people who are starving. You will send money to victims of disasters. You will want to lead a life that is morally sound and ethically just. And sometimes you will succeed, even though you will fail as well. But you'll know you have Christ in your heart, and when you do fail, you don't like it. It was in that moment when Zacchaeus realizes who Jesus is, that he doesn't like who he is, that he wants to change. And what a change. I'll just give away half my stuff, and then if I've defrauded anybody, I'll pay them back fourfold. I wonder if Zacchaeus had any money left when he was finished. Because I think there was a long line. That doesn't come in the happy story. Then a long line of people said, "Okay, Zacchaeus, you owe me a lot of money. I'd like to see that times four." But in extra biblical sources, which we don't preach from, but we can talk about, we hear that Zacchaeus becomes the first bishop of Caesarea. Now, Jericho is an old, important town, but Caesarea was a Roman city in Palestine, in Israel, and a big deal. And we remember his name. I think Zacchaeus, in his change, was happy to pay everybody back. He went for the outward change. The change is to live with Christ in your heart. That's what it is. What do we do when we're changed by grace? When we come to this table, we get this new condition, something recognizable outward in our life. It changes us the same way. We become more generous. We become more aware of places where people are suffering through no fault of their own. And we become aware of people who are suffering precisely because of their own mistakes. And we love them as well and help them. We see people in trouble, we want to help them find peace. We see people living comfortably with their sin, and we want to show them the light that has found us. To say we undergo a physical change is true. We also get an obligation, do we not? People see Christ in us when we show our compassion. But as people who follow Christ, we are obligated to demonstrate it. If and only if we submit ourselves to Christ will people see that outward physical change that occurs. We are called from our comfort zone. So I invite you the same way that Jesus invited Zacchaeus, to come down from whatever limb you're on into the love of God, into the work of God, into the hand of God. Why don't we all come down and get ourselves grounded in Christ? Amen. Please remain seated for our hymn 521 in remembrance of me. Receive each of us also, O Lord, as living sacrifices, henceforth to your glory, Father, Son, and Spirit, world without end. Amen. On the night in which he was betrayed, our Savior took bread. And when he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me."
In the same manner also, our Savior took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. All of you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." You all are welcome and invited to hold the elements until all have served, so we can partake of them together. The gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
blood of Christ shed for you. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that you have fed us at your table with spiritual food and assured us in your goodness towards us that we are members of the mystical body of your Son and heirs of your everlasting kingdom. Help us abide with your grace so that we may continue to live and serve you alone, Father, Son, and Spirit, world without end. Now I invite you to stand as you are able and let us affirm what we believe, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. Third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the union of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our closing hymn, 630, Fair Us, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
fallen, and to present you without blemish before the presence of his glory with rejoicing. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen.